today my case on a parole swelling. I'm presenting the case of a 40-year-old gentleman working as a manual laborer coming from Panipat, Haryana. His chief complaints were swelling in the right upper neck below the ear for the past 4 months, along with pain or the swelling for the past 1 month. He was apparently well till 4 months back when he noticed a swelling in the upper part of the right side of his neck and behind and front of the right ear. Initially, he said the swelling was about 5 to 6 centimeters, which gradually increased in size. And over the past 1 month, the swelling has increased rapidly in size to attain its current size of about 8 to 10 centimeters. He also gives a history of pain over the swelling for the past 10 days. It's a dull aching, deep-seated, continuous type of pain. The pain increases on opening the mouth and is not relieved on medications. There is no history of any radiation of pain to his ear. There is no history of any increase in size of the swelling while eating and no history of discharge from his vestibule of the mouth. There's no history of difficulty in swallowing. There's no history suggestive of facial nerve palsy such as deviation of face, difficulty in closing his eyes, chewing food or drooling of saliva. There's no history of any other swelling over the neck. There's no history of fever, cough or evening rise of temperature. And there's no history suggestive of metastasis. He has no history of diabetes, hypertension or tuberculosis. There's no history of previous surgeries or hospital admissions. There's no history of any radiation exposure and no past history of mumps. His sleep, appetite, bowel, bladder habits are normal. He consumes a mixed diet. There's no history of weight loss or loss of appetite. He has a history of smoking tobacco about 20 pack years and no history of alcohol intake or chewing tobacco. He has no family history of head and neck malignancies, and the patient has not received any treatment for his condition in the past. To summarize the history, it's a 40-year-old gentleman who presents a history of progressive swelling in the region of the right parotid gland for the past 4 months, with pain and rapid increase in size for the past 1 month, with no history suggestive of facial nerve involvement.
You mentioned, I think I've seen this presentation sometime before.
Yes, sir.
Maybe last time also. Eating, chewing. The fluctuation in the size that you're looking at is not on eating. Chewing is the word, right?
Yes, sir.
And why did you take the history of referral to the ear, the pain getting referred?
He complains of pain below and behind the ear, so most probably.
So he has pain. Yes. What do you think is the cause for that? If you were in the workshop yesterday, then you would have seen what we were showing there.
There are many reasons for pain in the. If you're considering an enlarged parotid gland, it could be an enlarged mass causing tension within the parotid capsule or obstruction of the parotid duct, or if it's a malignant swelling involving the sensory nerve supplies like the mandibular nerve or the maxillary nerves.
Okay. Any question in the history?
Yeah,
we need to stick to time.
Yes, you said that there is swelling in the neck. And here you're talking about swelling in the parotid area. Where exactly is the swelling? We haven't seen the image.
Yes, ma'am. Should I show the image?
That will be in the examination, but you can take anything in the history that we need.
So
when you're saying swelling, basically the point taken is head and neck is a big area, so you can be specific even in the beginning. So swelling in around the ear or under the ear is what would have helped,
yes,
rather than saying swelling on one side of the face.
Yes,
am I right, madam?
No, this is swelling on one side in the neck.
No, ma'am. I said swelling behind
go back
the
to your slides in the
can
history.
You go back?
History of presenting illness, yes.
So upper actually is mentioned in front of the right ear. This is covered. But why did the question come up? You cannot argue with the examiner on that day.
Yes,
so why do you think it come up? It's a good trial for the exam. Sometimes it may not be heard. So what could you have done better to make it heard better? The swelling around the ear,
yeah,
or so automatically that's a part of the neck only.
Yes.
So then the attention wouldn't have completely been lost. Anything, Parul, Rahul, quick.
So around the ear, it has to be something differential diagnosis of pre-auricular, post-auricular, or upper jugular.
No, that in the history, you won't
so
say that.
History,
sir.
Did you take anything that will suggest it is not a lymph node swelling?
It's not. He does not complain of any fever, any cough, ear discharge.
In that case also.
Any swelling around the ear, take a history of ear discharge. Any hearing loss, okay?
Something in the scalp, any lesions in the scalp, even they can cause lymph nodes in this area.
I think very well presented history. I have no question. Just one point, since you said he comes from Panipat, it'll make you smarter. And he smokes. Panipat is a place where there is a very big Indian oil refinery. So you can justify in case it is malignant, then in discussion you can say whether he was exposed to refinery fumes or not, things like that.
Yes, okay. Sir. Thank you.
Did you take any history of swelling elsewhere?
Yes, ma'am. Elsewhere in the neck.
What did you look for? Elsewhere in the neck. Anywhere else?
He does not complain of any swelling elsewhere in
the
neck.
If you would have asked for, what would be in your
any
mind?
Other lymph node involvement?
Other than that? Would you have talked about any other swelling on the face also, say the other parotid, the lacrimal glands, and
yes.
history of joint
yes.
pains?
If there is
any
some suspecting Sjögren's.
Dryness of mouth and eyes?
Yes,
if so
yes.
these you could have added.
All right. So points added there. Yes. Basically, what is the most common cause of swelling in the neck?
A lymph node enlargement.
What is the most common cause of lymph node involvement?
Tuberculosis in our part of the country.
Tuberculosis in this part of the world, malignancy in the metastasis in the western side. So include those all those conditions in the history that'll cover up this area. Let's move.
On examination, the patient was examined in sitting position after exposing his head, neck, and mid-chest. Appropriate consent was taken and he was examined in good lighting. The patient was alert, conscious, and cooperative, and his performance scale was 90. The patient was thin built and of anxious faces and well hydrated. His facial symmetry is maintained. He has no pallor, no icterus, no clubbing, colonechia, lymphadenopathy, generalized lymphadenopathy or pedal edema. His BMI is 20.2 and his vitals, his pulse rate is 88 beats per minute, BP 124/90, respiratory rate of 16 per minute, and he's afebrile. On examination, this is a picture of his, from the lateral aspect and from the anterior.
Just hold it there. Tell us the regions that this swelling is covering.
So the region is mainly involving the parotid region, along with extension. It's extending below that into the over the sternocleidomastoid, like the posterior triangle and the anterior triangles of the neck.
So the swelling is in the parotid region partly.
Yes, sir.
Then in the submandibular region.
And
then also, as you said, partly it is over the sternomastoid.
Sternomastoid. Yes, sir.
Partly to the, into the posterior triangle.
Yes,
that's
sir.
What you're saying.
Yes, sir.
All right. Any. Well, since I stopped you for just a moment, we can finish your presentation now.
Yes. On inspection, the swelling is located in the region, mainly located in the region of the right parotid gland, extending downwards into the anterior and posterior triangles of the neck, measuring vertically about 10 centimeters and horizontally about 7 centimeters. It's ovoid shape, margins are well defined, and the surface appears lobulated. The right ear lobule is lifted upwards and the retroauricular groove is obliterated.
How would you know this is lifted? You should need to show us from behind or you should need to show both sides, no?
Yes, sir.
Otherwise, it won't be appreciated that well. Anyway, carry on.
The retroauricular groove is obliterated. The skin of the swelling and the platysma appear stretched. There are no dilated veins, scars, sinuses or any visible pulsations. The opposite parotid gland appears normal. All the other salivary glands appear normal. There are no other visible swellings in the head and neck region. On inspection of the oral cavity, the mouth opening is normal. The tonsils and the tonsillar pillars are pushed medially, and the opening of the parotid duct is normally situated. Coming to the palpation, there's a local rise of temperature, and there's tenderness present over the swelling. It's 12 centimeters in its vertical dimensions and 8 in its horizontal dimension, situated mainly in the right parotid region, extending downwards. It's ovoid in shape with well-defined margins. The surface is irregular and it's hard in consistency. The skin of the swelling is smooth and stretched, and the skin is it's attached to the overlying skin and the underlying sternocleidomastoid. The swelling becomes more prominent and contracting the ipsilateral sternocleidomastoid. The Curtin sign is positive, and the common carotid artery pulsations could not be felt on the right side, or the superficial temporal artery pulsations could be felt. The submandibular gland was normal on the right side. On examination of the facial nerve, the facial asymmetry is preserved. The orbicularis oculi, the frontal belly of the occipital frontalis, the buccinator, orbicularis aura, and the levator angular oris and the platysma were all found to be normal. There was a single enlarged level 5 lymph node on the right side measuring 1 into 1 centimeter, which is hard and mobile. Level 2, level 3 lymph nodes could not be assessed because of the overlying swelling. The other salivary gland on the opposite parotid was normal. The 11th cranial nerve examination was normal. Temporomandibular joint examination, the mouth opening was normal and the movements of the temporomandibular joint were normal. On systemic examinations, there were no other abnormalities detected. To summarize my history and examination, there's a 40-year-old gentleman who has a history of progressive enlargement of the right parotid gland for the past 4 months with pain and rapid increase in size over the last 1 month. On examination, the right parotid gland is 12 into 8 centimeters, hard in consistency, it's tender and fixed to the skin with enlargement of the deep lobe, with involvement of a single level 5 cervical lymph node with no evidence suggestive of facial nerve involvement.
Can you show us the intraoral picture?
So I could not take the intraoral picture.
Why? He couldn't open his mouth?
He could open his mouth, but...
Or you didn't have a camera?
I had a blurred image, so it wasn't... I couldn't get a clear image.
Wish that you had shown us. What did... And you found that the pillar was pushed.
The pillar was pushed along with the tonsils.
Mm. And see, again, go back to the picture. I mean, my problem is you are stuffing this diagnosis somewhere. Well, it can easily be something else, right? Because it is lying in a position which is... Okay, let's say the examiner wants to help you.
Yes, sir.
He'll ask you questions that are very easily answered. What are the boundaries of parotid region?
So the parotid region is bound by two horizontal lines. The upper line at the level of the zygomatic process and lower the angle of the mandible. And then two anterior and posterior lines. The anterior line drawn midpoint of the zygomatic arch and the posterior one at the mastoid process.
So if you draw it with your cursor on this patient,
yes, sir.
No, in the same picture? Yeah. Can you do that? Yes.
So,
draw the vertical line first. Horizontal lines first.
The horizontal line, the first line would be here, the superior line.
No. Horizontal upper one would be at the level of the zygomatic arch,
zygomatic arch.
That's it. Go straight up.
Yes. Zygomatic arch.
Yeah. Okay.
And then...
The lower one would be at the angle of mandible.
Angle of mandible. Here.
Yeah, do that. What is the problem in drawing a line there with the cursor? The cursor is not working or what?
It's not working.
I use cursor all the time.
Pointer.
Okay, do with the pointer. Yes, that's better. Yes.
And this is the
horizontal line. Then push the mastoid process and the midpoint. Now, how much of the swelling you think is lying in this region?
It's about 50-60% of the swelling.
And 50% is outside. Which is the other region you're looking at? Some mandibular, you said. And in the region of level 2 lymph nodes, isn't it?
Yes.
It's classically level 2. Can you isolate this swelling? Yeah.
So there is a group.
I am asking a question, just answer that. Don't try things. Just isolate it with a marker. No, just the lower swelling, which is lying separately. This looks like a level 2 lymph node. Am I right? Is it connected to the upper one?
Yes, sir, it is connected.
So could they be just lymph nodes?
They could
it's possible. Okay. Now, Dr. Ratna, you wanted to ask.
Again, I feel there are some contentious issues when it comes to your presentation. Because you said that this swelling is superficial to sternocleidomastoid.
Yes.
The whole swelling you said is superficial to sternocleidomastoid.
Yes.
At the same time, you said that the tonsillar pillars are displaced.
Yes.
You mean to say this is the superficial lobe and there is a deep lobe which is separate from this? Is that what is what
yes,
you're
ma'am.
Trying to say?
Yes, ma'am. The deep lobe and the superficial lobe are in.
And at the same time, you feel, you know, because I feel the other swelling, sir, which is there in front is right, absolutely anterior to the sternocleidomastoid. I don't think this swelling should be superficial to sternocleidomastoid, but you are, because you've clinically examined, you would know better. To my mind, these two...
This is... Let's solve one issue at a time. How did you ascertain this is superficial to sternocleidomastoid? You do get difficult scenarios, which are not classically parotid, not classically submandibular, not classically lymph node. So if you're clever, you will handle it in piecemeal. Otherwise, you're saying few things which support one swelling, they don't support the other one. That is why these questions are coming up. It is not that a level 2 lymph node cannot go inside, become so large that it can push in the tonsillar pillar, but then you need to be clear on that part. Now, how did you establish that it is superficial to sternocleidomastoid?
When we asked the patient to contract his neck.
So what happened after that?
It becomes more prominent.
So it became more prominent, right? All the entire swelling became more prominent or part of it?
No, part of the swelling is, the lower part of the swelling.
So therefore you can easily bail yourself out of it by saying I could not appreciate in the upper part because you can't see the tendon.
Yes, sir.
But lower part, you can see the sternomastoid, and that's where you could appreciate that it is superficial to sternomastoid. Now, what do you mean by it is superficial to sternomastoid? I'm not leaving you there. You're getting stuck into it further. Because what would happen if a swelling is superficial to sternomastoid? Where is it lying?
Subcutaneous.
So, sternomastoid is invested by the investing layer of deep fascia. So, the swelling, even if it tries,
yes,
and if it is a parotid or a lymph node, whatever you are calling it, I am not saying it. This is too low for parotid. You also understand
yes,
that
yes,
it can happen. You can come out of the tail, but But it will be deep to sternomastoid or superficial?
It will be deep to the sternum.
If you had said, I could not appreciate on account of the muscle being completely surrounded, I would not say anything. Mm-hmm. She's asking you this question for a simple reason that you're so categorically saying it is superficial to the sternomastoid muscle.
Yes, sir.
Am I right?
Yes, sir.
Is it superficial to sternomastoid?
So it appeared more prominent on contracting.
So could it be part of it?
Part of the sternocleidomastoid?
Otherwise, how do you explain it is? I mean, why do you think it becomes more prominent? Because the fascia is stretched. So the swellings may become more prominent, but that would not mean it is superficial to sternomastoid.
Yes,
don't apply the same logic. In a relaxed position, is it moving over sternomastoid?
No, sir. I mean, it's not moving over sternocleidomastoid.
I knew how to get you there.
It's not moving.
So where are we? So, there is a problem.
Yes,
when you have level 2 growing large, it will displace the sternomastoid. Sometimes it can go through the fibers, but it can never become superficial. Like we say for thyroid, it can never become superficial because it's lying deep to the deep fascia. What is the plane of this swelling according to you?
According to me, it's subcutaneous if it is...
This is a subcutaneous swelling.
No. If it is becoming more prominent on...
No, answer the question. What do you think finally is the plane
finally
of this?
It's deep to the deep fascia.
So let's not get absurd there, no?
Yes,
deep to deep fascia.
The examination of oral cavity could have been more complete rather than just talking about the tonsillar pillars, because you could have told us that the oral cavity per se is normal, including the tongue and the posterior one.
It's so important here because oral cavity examination in this patient can find a lesion which can cause get your diagnosis of a lymph node.
Yes, sir.
And examination of when you said the tonsillar pillar is displaced, right?
Yes, sir.
What was in your mind? Deep lobe?
Yes, sir, deep lobe.
Now, did you go for bidigital examination?
Bidigital exam palpation is not done.
Not normally done. Why? Gag. So he can bite you. But it's an inspectory finding.
Yes,
it's all right. You can have, just because you found the pillars displaced, that doesn't become a parotid swelling.
Yes.
So that part you need to sort out. What is the plane of the swelling?
Yes, sir.
It's lying deep to, please don't play with it. Something is wrong. Now, Rahul, you were asking.
All these rules, what you're talking about, planes, they're all defined and they're broken by secondaries of the lymph node. If it is secondary of the lymph node, they can break the deeper planes and they can come into subcutaneous plane also.
But not only secondaries, even parotid can do that. When it is malignant, it can go through.
It can break all the planes.
So actually, you should be able to defend yourself by saying exactly the point.
Transformation,
sir, you don't know really, but you committed.
Yes, sir.
That's why they're asking you. What is the usual plane of lymph nodes? Deep to deep fascia. We're talking about deep nodes,
yes,
no? When you talk about deep cervical groups.
Yes, sir.
So you should not unnecessarily buy a problem.
Yes, sir.
Right? Any other point? Sumit?
Actually, by look of it, these two swellings seems to be different.
Yes.
As per its consistency as well as the surface and everything. So both may be mingled with each other because of the large size of the swelling. But both are different. As you have already said, the upper part might be you are feeling that it is also, you can feel it in the oral cavity examination.
Yes, sir.
As per inspection.
You can see it, yes, sir.
The lower part you cannot.
No, sir.
And actually, it is vital to include, especially in these cases, all those who are presenting, to have the intraoral picture because it gives you an impression. You getting the point?
Yes, sir.
Now give us a summary of your diagnosis. Like you understand, no?
Yes, sir.
It indicates it's a malignant process.
Yes, sir.
Which breaks all the planes.
Please.
Then you don't have a well-defined, location. But so don't commit on... you mentioned about carotids not being palpable. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
But superficial temporal artery was palpable. That's a good point, which indicates that carotid is free. Otherwise, indirectly, you could get an evidence of this. So what do you think has happened to carotid? Why is it not palpable? Because the swelling is lying where you need to palpate. Can you palpate it lower down?
We could.
See, these are points. You're not scoring there at all. You should have got the carotid pulse. You should mention that up till this level, I could palpate it. Beyond that, there's a swelling, so I can't palpate it. Okay, let's move.
The diagnosis?
No, diagnosis. We will start with this, huh?
The diagnosis? A 40-year-old gentleman with right side malignant parotid gland tumor with a deep lobe involvement with a single enlarged cervical lymph node without evidence of facial lobe involvement.
This lymph node is different from the swelling you are showing us?
Yes, sir.
Now, this entire thing is parotid swelling according to you?
Yes, it looks like one.
You would still not change your stance?
No.
No, no. It's your right to you. It's a free country.
It's a single swelling.
Get killed. You're free to get killed. Nobody will stop you. It's a free country.
Yes, huh? It's a single swelling with...
What makes it parotid for you?
It occupies the region of the parotid gland.
You think so? 50% only? 50% marks?
There is a displacement of the tonsillar pillars.
You are actually fiddling with it. That's the problem. Just leave it there. No?
Displacement of the tonsillar pillars immediately.
Displacement of tonsillar pillar doesn't make any swelling a parotid swelling. What are the characteristics of a parotid swelling? One, it lies in parotid region.
Yes.
Agreed.
Yes.
What is that curtain sign you were talking about?
When you try to move the parotid...
Is it there in your picture?
Yes, sir.
Show it. Can you make it into a slideshow without touching anything else? Yes. Is it visible?